Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about nearest neighbor methods. Nearest neighbor methods use those observative in the training set T closest in input space to x to the y cap. Especially the k nearest neighbor fit for y cap is defined like this equation, where nk of x is the neighborhood of x defined by the k closest points xi in the training sample. Closeness implies a matrix which for a moment we assume in Euclidean distance. So inward we find the k observation with xi closed to x in input space and average their response. In this picture, we see the same training data and use 15 nearest neighbors averaging of the binary coded response as the method of fitting. Thus, y cap is the proportion of orange in the neighborhood, and so assigning class orange to g cap if y cap greater than 0.5 amounts to a majority vote in the neighborhood. The color region indicates all those points in input space classified as blue or orange by such a rule, in this case found by evaluating the procedure on a fine grid in input space. We see that the decision boundaries that separate the blue from the orange region are for more irregular and responds to local clusters where one class dominates. In this case, the region of classification can be computed relatively easily and correspond to a Voronoi tessellation of the training data. Each point xi has associated tile bounding the region for which it is the closest input point. For all points, x is the tile, g cap of x equal to gi. The decision boundary is even more irregular than before. The method of k nearest neighbor averaging is defined is exactly the same way of regression of a quantitative output y, although k equal to 1 would be an unlikely choice. And in this picture, we see that fewer training observations are misclassified. This should not give us too much comfort, though, since none of the training data are misclassified. A little, though, suggests that for k nearest neighbor fits, the error on the training data should be approximately an increasing function of k and will always be 0 for k equal to 1. An independent test set would give us a more satisfactory means for comparing the different methods. It appears that k nearest neighbors fits have a single parameter, the number of neighbors k, compared to the p parameters in least square fits. Although this is the case, we will see the effective number of parameters of k nearest neighbors in n by k and is generally bigger than p and decrease with increasing k. To get an idea of why, note that if the neighborhood were non-overlapping, there would be n by k neighborhood and we would fit on parameter in each neighborhood. It is also clear that we cannot use sum of square errors on the training set as a criterion for picking k, since we would always pick k equal to 1. It would seem that k nearest neighbor methods would be more appropriate for the mixer scenario to described above, while for Gaussian data, the decision boundaries of k nearest neighbor would be unnecessarily noisy. and this is the picture nearest neighbor classifier, the same classifier example in two dimension. The classes are coded as a binary variable, blue equal to 0, orange equal to 1, and then predicted by one nearest neighbor classification. Now from least square to nearest neighbors. The linear decision boundary from least square is very smooth and apparently stable to fix. It does appear to rely heavily on the assumption that a linear decision boundary is appropriate. In language we will develop shortly, it has low variance and potentially high bias. On the other hand, the k nearest neighbor procedure do not appear to rely on any stringent assumption about the underlying data and can adapt to any situation. However, any particular subregion of the decision boundary depends on a handful of input points and their particular position and is thus wiggy and unstable. High variance and low bias. Each method has its own situation for which it works best. In particular, linear regression is more appropriate from scenario 1 above, while nearest neighbors are more suitable for scenario 2. The time has come to expose and oracle. The data in fact were simulated from almost somewhere between the two, but closer to scenario 2. First, we generated 10 means mk from a bivariate Gaussian distribute n and labeled this class blue. Similarly, 10 more were drawn from n of 0, 1 to the power 1, comma I and labeled class orange. Then, for each class, we generated 100 observations as follows. For each observation, we pick an mk and random with portability 1 by 10. And look like this picture. Misclassification curves for the simulation example used angle training, a sample size 200 was used, and a test sample of size 10,000. The orange curves are test and the blue are training error for k nearest neighbor classification. The results for linear regression are the bigger orange and blue square at 3 degrees of freedom. The purple line is the optimal bias error rate. And in this picture shows the result of classifying 10,000 new observations generated from the model. We compare the result for least square and those for k nearest neighbor for a range of value of k. A larger subset of the most popular techniques in use today are variant of these two sample procedure. In fact, one nearest neighbor, the samplest of all, capture a large percentage of the market for low dimensional problem. The list describes some way in which this sample procedure have been enhanced. Number one, kernel method was weights that decrease smoothly to zero with distance from the target point rather than the effective 0 by 1 weight used by k nearest neighbor. In high dimensional space, the distance kernel are modified to emphasize some variable more than other. Local regression fits linear models by locally weighted last square rather than fitting constants locally. Linear models fit to a bias expansion of the original input allow attributary complex model. projection pursuit and neural network model consist of sums of non-linearly transformed linear models. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about statistical decision theory. In this section, we develop a small amount of theory that provides a framework for developing models such as those discussed informally so far. We first consider the case of a quantitative output and place ourselves in the world of random variable that portability aspects, let x belongs to region 2 the power p, denote a real valued random input vector, and y belongs to region a real valued random output variable. With joint distribution pair x, y, we seek a function f of x for predicting y gives values for the input x. This theory requires a loss function L of y of f of x for penalizing errors in prediction, and by far the most common and convenient is square error loss L of y of f of x equal to y minus f of x square. Now look at this equation 2.9 and 2.20. The expected prediction error by conditioning on x, we can write EPE as like this 2.11 equation. And we see that the suffers to minimize EPE pointwise f of x equal to r minimum like this 2.12 equation. And the solution is 2.13 equation f of x equal to e of y by x minus equal to x. The condition expectation, also known as the regression function, thus the best prediction of y at any point x equal to x is the conditional mean when best is measured by average squared error. The nearest neighbor method attempts to directly implement this recipe using the training data. At each point of x, we might ask for the average of all, where f done average, thus yis with input equal to x, since there is typically at most one observation at any point x, we settle for like this equation, where f denotes average and nk of x is the neighborhood containing the k point in t closet to x. Two approximations are happening here. Number one exception is approximate by averaging over sample data, and number two, conditioning at a point is relaxed to conditioning on some region close to the target point. For large training sample size n, the points in the neighborhood are likely to be close to x, and as k gets large, the average will get more stable. In fact, undermined regularity conditions on the joint portability distribution PRX, Y, one can show that as n, k tends to infinity, such that k by n tends to 0, f cap of x tends to e, y by x equal to x. In light of this, why look further? Since it seems we have a universal approximator, we often do not have any large samples. If the linear or sample more structured model is appropriate, then we can usually get a more stable estimate than k nearest neighbors. Although such knowledge has to be learned from the data as well. There are other problems though, sometimes data disaster. We see that as the dimension problem though, sometimes distance p gets large, so does the matrix size of the k nearest neighborhood. So setting for nearest neighborhood as a surrogate for conditioning will fail us miserably. The convergence above still holds, but the rate of convergence decreases as the dimension increases. How does linear regression fit into the framework? The simplest explanation is that one assumption that the regression function f of x is approximately linear in these arguments, like this 2.15 equation. This is a model-based approach. We specify a model for the regression function, plugging this linear model for f of x into EVE, and differentiating we solve for beta theoretically in this equation. Note we have not conditioned on x, rather we have used our knowledge of the functional relationship to pull over value of x. The least square solution amounts to replacing the exception by this equation and average over the training data. So both k-nearest neighbors and test square ends up approximately conditional expression by average, but they differ dramatically each lens of model assumption. Least square assumption f of x is well approximated by a globally linear function. K-nearest neighbor assumes f of x is well approximated by a locally constant function. Although the latter seems more palatable, we have already seen that we may pay a price for its flexibility. Many of the more modern techniques described are model-based, although far more flexible than the rich linear model. For example, additive model assumes like that. This retains the additivity of the linear model, but each coordinate function f of j is arbitrary. It turns out that the optimal estimate for the additive model uses techniques such as k-nearest neighbor to approximate univariate condition expectation. Simultaneously, for each of the coordinate function, thus the problem of estimating a coordinate exception in higher dimension are swept away in this case by imposing some model assumption in the case additivity. Are we happy with the certain criterion? What happens if we replace the L2 loss function with the L1 slice E by Y minus F of X? The solution in this class is the conditional median, like this 2.8 equation, which is defined measures of location and the estimate are more robust than those for the conditional mean. L1 criteria has discontinuous in their derivatives, which have hindered their widespread use. Other more resistant loss function will be mentioned in later, but a squared error is analysis convenient and the most popular. Our loss function can be represented by a k by k matrix L, where k equal to cut of g. L will be 0 on the diagonal and non-negative elsewhere. Where L of KL is the price paid for classifying an observation belonging to class G of K and G of L. Most often we use the 0-1 loss function, where all misclassification are changed a single unit. The expected prediction error is like this equation. When again the expectation is taken with respect to the joint distribution, here g, x, again we condition and can write a PEA as like this 2.20 equation. And look at this picture. The optimal Bayes decision boundaries for the simulation example. Since the generating density is known for each class, this boundary can be calculated especially and gain its suffices to minimize EPE pointwise, that is the 2.21 equation. With the 0-1 loss function, this simplifies to 2.2 equation, or simply is the 2.23 equation. The reasonable solution is known as the Bayes classifier and says that we classify to the most portable class. Using the conditional distribution, the Bayes optimal decision boundary for our simulation example. The error rate of the Bayes classifier is called the Bayes rate. Again, we see that the k-nearest neighbor classifier directly approximates this solution. A majority vote in a nearest neighborhood amounts to exactly this, except this conditional probability at a point is relaxed to conditional probability within a neighborhood of a point, and portabilities are estimated by training sample proportion. Suppose for a two class problem we had taken the dummy variable approach and coded g via a binary y followed by a square error loss estimation, then f cap y x equal to e of y by x, here g equal to g1 by x if g1 correspondent to y1. Likewise for a k class problem, e yk by x equal to prg equal to gk by k. This shows that our dummy variable regression procedure followed by classification to the largest fitted value. In another way to representing the Bayes classifier, although this theory is extant, in practice problem can occur depending on the regression model used. For example, when linear regression is used, f cap of x need to be positive and we might be surprised about using at least an estimate of a probability. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about linear discriminant analysis, decision theory for classification. Tells us that we need to know the class posteriors, here g by x, for optimal classification. Suppose fk of x is to class conditional density of x in the class g equal to k, and let phi of k be the prior portability of class k with summation of k to k equal to 1, phi of k equal to 1. A simple appropriate of Bayes and look like this picture, a two dimension plot of the vowel training data. There are elephant class with x belongs to region 2^10, and this is the best view in terms of LDA model. The heavy circle are the project means vector for each class. The class overlap is considerable. And this is the table training and test error rules. rate using a variety of linear techniques on the vowel data. There are 11 classes in 10 dimensions, of which 3 account for 90% of the variance. We see that linear regression is hard by masking. Increasing the test and training error by over 10%. Theorem gives us like this equation. We see that in terms of ability to classify, having the f of k x is almost equivalent to having the quantity pr g equal to k by x equal to x. Many techniques are based on models for the class densities. Linear and quadratic discriminant analysis use Gaussian densities. More flexible mixture of Gaussian allows for nonlinear division boundaries. General non-parametric density estimates for each class density allow the most flexibility. Native Bayes models are a variant of the previous case and assume that each of the class densities are product of marginal densities. That is, they assume that the input are cardinally depends in each class. Suppose that we model each class density as multivariate Gaussian, look like this. Linear discriminant analysis arises in the special case when we assume that the classes have a common covariant matrix, summation of k equal to summation of attribute k. In comparing two class k and l, it is sufficient to look at the log ratio and we see that the equation. An equation linear in X, the equal covariant matrix causes the normalized vector to cancel, as well as the quadratic part in the exponent. This linear log ors function implies that the division boundary between classes K and L, the set where PR G equal to K by X, equal to PR G by L by x equal to x, is linear in x. In p dimensions, a hyperplane, this is of course true for any pair of classes. So all the division boundaries are linear. If we divided region to the power p into region that are classified as class 1, class 2, etc., these regions will be separated by hyperplanes, shows an idealized example with 3 class and p equal to 2. Here the data do arise from the Gaussian distribution with a common covariant matrix. We have included in the figure of the constant corresponding to 90% highest whatever density, and this is the picture. Notice that the division boundaries are not the perpendicular bisectors of the line segment joining the centroids. This would be the class if the covariance summation were spherical sigma square I and the class priors were equal. We see that the linear discriminant function look like this and our equivalent description of the division rules with g of x equal to argument maximum k del k of x. In practice, we do not know the parameter of the Gaussian distributes, and we will need to estimate them using our training data. Look like this. The estimation boundary is based on a sample of size 30 each from the Gaussian distribution. With two classes, there is a simple correspondence between linear discriminant analysis and classification by linear least square. And that is the equation. And class 1 otherwise, suppose we quote the target in the two classes as plus 1 and minus 1 respectively, it is easy to show that the coefficient vector from least square is proportional to the LDA direction given in Etho. In fact, the correspondence occurs for any coding of the targets. However, unless n1 equal to n2, the intercepts are different and hence the resulting decision rules are different. Since the derivation of the LDA directions by least square does not use a Gaussian assumption for the features, inapplicability extends beyond the realm of Gaussian data. However, the derivation of the particular intercept or cut point given as does require Gaussian data. Thus, it makes sense to instead choose the cut point and that completely minimize training error for a given data set. This is something we have found to work well in practice, but we have not seen it mentioned in the literature. Getting back to the generalized discriminant problem, if the summation of k are not assumed to be equal, then the covariant cancellation do not occur. In particular, the piece quadratic in x remain, we then get quadratic determinant function like this equation. The decision boundary between each pair of class k and L is described by equation quadratic. The right float use QDA described here, while the left float use LDA in the enlarged 5-dimensional quadratic polynomial space. The estimate of QDA is similar to those for LDA. Expect that separate covariance matrix must be estimated for each class. When P is large, this can mean a dramatic increase in parameter. Since the decision boundaries are function of this parameter of this dentist, counting the making number of parameter must be done with care. For LDA, it seems there are k minus 1 into p plus 1 parameter. Since we only need the difference del k of x minus del k of x. And look at this picture. The two methods for getting quadratic boundaries, the left plot shows the quadratic decision boundaries for the data . The right plot shows the quadratic decision boundaries found by QDA. The difference are small, as is usually the case. between the discriminate function where k is some pre-chosen class and each difference requires p+1 parameters. Likewise for QDA, there will be k-1 into p+3/2+1 parameter. Both LDA and QDA perform well on the amazingly large and diverse set of classification tasks. For example, in StateLog project, LDA was among the top 3 classification of for 7 of the 22 dataset. QDA among the top 3 for 4 dataset and 1 for the pair were in the top other 3 for 10 dataset. Both techniques are widely used and entire books are devoted to LDA. The reason is not likely to be that the data are approximately Gaussian, and in addition for LDA that the covariance are approximately equal. For likelier reason is that the data can only support simple decision boundaries such as linear or quadratic, and the estimate provides why the Gaussian models are stable. This argument is less believable for QDA since it can have many parameters itself, although perhaps fewer than the non-parametric alternatives. And this is the another picture, regulation discriminant analysis on the vowel data. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about regularized discriminant analysis. Feynman proposed a compromise between LDA and QDA, which allows on to shrink the separate covariance of QDA towards a common allows on to shrink the separate covariance of QDA. Towards a common covariance as in LDA. These methods are very similar in flavor to this regression. The regularized covariance matrix have the form look like this equation. The summation cap is the pooled covariance matrix as used in LDA. Here alpha belongs to 0,1, allows a quantitatum of modules between LDA and QDA and needs to be satisfied. In practice, alpha can be chosen based on the performance of the model on the validation data or by cross-validation. The large discrepancy between the training and test error is partly due to the fact that there are many respect measurements on a small number of individuals. Defined is the training and test set. Similar modification allows summation cap itself to be shrunk towards the scalar covariance like this equation. We discuss other regulation version of LDA which are more suitable when the data rise from data digitalized among singles and images. In this situation, the features are high dimensional and correlated, and the LDA coefficient can be regularized to be smooth or sphere in the original domain of the single. This leads to better generalization and allows for easier interpretation of a coefficient. This the method focused on the case gamma equal to 0 and other severely regularized version of LDA. Now computation for LDA. As a lead in the next topic, we briefly digress on the computation required for LDA and especially QDA. their computation as simplified by diagonalized summation cap or summation cap of k. For the latter, suppose we compute the eigen decomposition for E summation k cap equal to uk dk uk to the power t, where uk is p by p orthogonal and dk is a diagonal matrix of positive eigenvalues dkl, then the ingredient for del k of x are look like this. In light of the computational step online above, the LDA classifier can be implemented by the following pair of steps. Spread the data with respect to the common covariance estimates summation cap equal to x integer d to the power minus half e to the power tx, where e to the power cap equal to u d u to the power t. The common covariance estimate of x integer will now be the identity. Classify to the closest class centroid in the transform sphere modulo the effect of the class superior portabilities I of k. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about multiple regression from simple univariate regression. The linear model with p greater than 1 inputs is called the multiple linear regression model. The least square estimates for this model are best understood in terms of the estimates for the univariate p equal to 1 linear model, as we indicate in this section. Suppose first that we have a univariate model with no intercept, that is the equation number 3.23. The least square estimate and residuals are 3.24 equation like this. In convenient vector notation, we let y equal to y1 to yn to the power t, x equal to x1 to x to the power n to the power t, like this 3.25 equation. The linear vector product between x and y, then we can write r equal to y by x of beta cap 3.26 equation like this. As we will see, this simple univariate regression provides the building block for multiple linear regression. Suppose next that the input x1, x2, to xp are orthogonal, that is xj, xk equal to 0. For all j is not equal to k, then it is easy to check that the multiple least square estimate beta cap of j are equal to xj y by xj xj. The univariate estimates, in other words, when the input are orthogonal, they have no effect on each other's parameter estimate in the model. Orthogonal input occur most often with balanced designed experiment, but almost never with observational data. Hence, we will have to orthogonalize them in order to carry this idea further. Suppose next that we have an intercept and a single input x, then the least square coefficient of x has the from 3.27 equation like this, where x bar equal to summation of I xi by n and 1 equal to x naught. The vector of n ones, we can view the estimate as the result of two application of the simple regression. The step are number one, regression x1 on 1 to produce the residual z equal to x minus x bar 1. Number 2, regress y on the residual z to give the coefficient beta 1 cap. In this procedure, regress v on a means a simply univariate regression of v on a with no intercept, producing coefficient gamma cap equal to a comma y by a comma a and residual vector v minus gamma cap a. We say that v is adjust for a or is orthogonalized with respect to a. Step 1, orthogonalized x with respect to x not equal to 1. Step 2 is just a simple unvaried regression. Using the orthogonal predictor 1 and z, the orthogonalized does not change the subspace spent by x1 and x2. It simply produces an orthogonal basis for representing it. This receives generalized to the case of p inputs and shown in algorithm. This receives generalized. Note that the input z0 to zj minus 1 in step 2 are orthogonal, hence the simple regression coefficient computed there are in fact also the multiple regression coefficients. And this is the picture, least square regression by orthogonal of the inputs. The vector x2 is regressed on the vector x1, leaving the residual vector z. The regression of y on z gives the multiple regression coefficient of x2. Adding together the projection of y on each of x1 and z gives the least square of it. The result of this algorithm is beta p cap equal to like this, equation 3.28. We arranging the residual in step 2, we can see that each of the xj is a linear combination of the zk, k less than or equal j. Since the zj are all orthogonal, they form a bias from the column space of x, and hence that least square projection onto this subspace is y cap. Since zp alone involves xp, we see that the coefficient is indeed the multiple regression coefficient of y on xp. This key result exposes the effect of correlated inputs in multiple regression. Note also that by rearranging the xj, any one of them could. Generally, we have shown that the jth multiple regression coefficient is the univariate regression coefficient of y on xj 0.012 to j minus 1 j plus 1 into dot dot p. The residual after regression xj on x0 x1 2 plus xj minus 1 xj plus 1 to xp. The multiple regression coefficient beta cap of j represent the additional contribution of xj on y. After xj has been adjusted of x0 x1 to xj minus 1 xj plus 1 to xp, if xp is highly correlated with some of the other xk's, the residual vector zp will be close to 0. And from given to equation, the coefficient beta cap of p will be very unstable. This will be true for all the variables in the correlated set. In such situation, we might have all the z cross, the small any one of the set can be deleted. Yet we cannot delete them all. From we also obtain a alternate formula for the variance estimate. look like this equation. In other words, the precision with which we can estimate beta cap of j depends on the length of the residual vector zp. We can obtain from it's not just beta cap of p, but also the entire multiple list square feet as shown. We can represent the step 2 of algorithm in matrix form 3.30 equation. The z has the column, the zj, and t is the appertaining matrix within tries gamma cap kj. Introducing the original matrix t with jth diagonal entry djj equal to zj, we get this equation. The so-called QR decomposition of X, here Q is an n equal into P plus 1 orthogonal matrix, Q to the power T, Q equal to I, and R is a P plus 1 into P plus 1 appertaining matrix. The QR decomposition represents a convenient orthogonal basis for the column space of X. It is easy to see, for example, that the least square solution is given by this equation. This equation is very easy to solve because R is upper triangular. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about multiple outputs. Suppose we have multiple outputs y1, y2 to yk that we wish to predict from our outputs x0, x1, x2 to xp. We assume a linear model for each outputs like this equation. With n training case, we can write the model in matrix notation y equal to xz plus e 3.36 equation. Here y is the n into k response matrix with ik entry yik, x is the n into p plus a input matrix. A straightforward generalized for a unvariable loss function is 3.37 and 3.38 equation. The least square estimate have exactly the same form as before, like this 3.39 equation. Hence the coefficient for the kth outcome are just the least square estimates in the regression of yk on x0, x1 to xp. Multiple outputs do not affect on another's least square estimate. If the errors epsilon equal to epsilon 1 to epsilon k are correlated, then it might seem appropriate to modify in favor of a multivariate version, especially suppose covariant of epsilon equal to summation, then the multivariate weighted criterions like this equation. Arise naturally from multivariate Gaussian theory, here f of x is the vector function and yi is the vector of k response for observation I. However, it can be shown that again the solution is given k specified regression that ignore the correlation. If the summation of I vary among observation, then this is no longer the case and the solution for v no longer description. Now subset selection. There are two reasons why we often not satisfy with the last square estimate. First of all, the first is prediction accuracy. The last square estimate often have low bias but large variance. Prediction accuracy can sometimes be improved by shrinking or setting some coefficient to zero. By doing so, we sacrifice a little bit of bias to reduce the variance of the predicted values, and hence many improve the overall prediction accuracy. Number 2 is interpretation. With a large number of predictors, we often would like to determine the smaller subset that exhibit the strongest effect. In order to get the big picture, we are willing to sacrifice of some details. In this section, we describe a number of approaches of variable subset selection with linear regression. This all fall under the general heading model section. Model section is not restricted to linear models. With subset selection, we retain only a subset of a variable and eliminate the rest from the model. Linear squares regression is used to estimate the coefficient of the input they are retained. There are a number of different strategies for choosing this subset. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about a structure local regression model in region to the power p. When the dimension to sample size ratio is unfavorable, local regression does not help as much unless we are willing to make some structure as assumption about the model. Much of this is about structure regression and classification models. Here we focus on some approaches directly related to kernel method. And look at this picture. The three-dimensional smooth example, the response is ozone concentration and the three predictors are temperature, wind speed and radiation. The trail is display shows ozone as a function of radiation conditioned on intervals of temperature and wind speed. Each panel contains about 40% of the range of each of the conditioned variable. The curve in each panel is a univariable local linear regression fit to the data in the panel. Now structured kernels. One line of approach is to modify the kernel. The default spherical kernel gives equal weight to each coordinate and so a natural default strategy is to standardize each variable to unit standard deviation. A major general approach is to use a positive semi-defined matrix A to weight the defined coordinates like this equation. Entire coordinate or these directions can be downgraded or omitted by imposing appropriate restrictions on A. For example, if A is diagonal, then we can increase or decrease the influence or individual predictors xj by increasing or decreasing ajj. Often the predictors are many and highly correlated, such as those arising from digitized analog signals or images. The covariance function of the predictors can be used to tailor a matrix A that focuses, let's say, on highly frequency constant. Proposals have been made for learning the parameters for multidimensional kernels. For example, the projection pursuit regression, a model discussed, is the of this flavor, where low rank version of A imply rich function for f of x k cap. More general models for A are cumbersome and we favor instead the structure forms for the regression function discussed next. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about structured regression functions. we are trying to fit a regression function e of y by x equal to f of x1, x2 to xp in region to the power p, in which every level of interaction is potentially present. It is natural to consider analysis of variance decompositions of the form like this equation, and then introduce a structure by eliminating some of the higher order terms. Additive models assumes only main effect terms. F of x equal to alpha plus summation of p of j equal to 1 gj xj. Second order models will have terms with interactions of order at most 2 and so on. We describe iterative backfitting algorithm for fitting such low order interaction model. In the additive model, for example, if all but the kth term is assumed known, then we can estimate gk by local regression of y minus summation of j is not equal to k gj xj on xk. This is done for each function in turn repeatedly. Unit convergence. The important detail is that at any stage, one-dimensional local regression is all that is needed. The same idea can be used to fit low-dimensional ANOVA decompositions. An important special case of this structure model are the class of varying coefficient models. Suppose, for example, that we divide the p predictors in x into the set x1, x2 to xp with q less than p and the remainder of the variable we collect in the vector. And look at this picture. In each panel of arrow diameter is modeled as a linear function of edge. The coefficient of the model vary with gender and dips down to the arota. There is a clear trend in the coefficient of the linear model. We then assume the conditionally linear model like this equation. For given z, this is a linear model, but each of the coefficient can vary with z. It is natural to fit such a model by locally weighted least squares. And this is the equation. And you saw this picture earlier, illustrated that idea of measurement of the human arota. A long standing claim has been that the arota thickness with age. How we model the diameter of the arota as a linear function of age, but allow the coefficient to vary with gender and depth down the arota. We used a local regression model separately for males and females. While the arota clearly does thicken with age at the higher region of the arota, the relationship fades with distance down the arota. And this picture shows the intercept and slope as a function of depth. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about optimism of the training error rate. Discussion of error rate estimate can be confusing because we have to make clear which quantities are fixed and which are random. Before we continue, we need a few definitions elaborating on the material of section. Given a training set T is equal to x1, y1, x2, y2 to xn, yn, the generalization error of a method f cap is like this equation. Note that the training set t is fixed in expression. The point x0, y0 is a new test data point drawn from f, the joint distribution of the data. Averaging over training set t yields the expected error, like this equation, which is more amenable to statistical analysis. As mentioned earlier, it turns out the most method effectively estimate the expected error rather than EA. See in section for more on this point. Now typically the training error like this will be less than the true error because the same data is being used to fit the method and access is error. A fitting method typically adapts to the training data, and hence the apparent of training error will be an overly optimistic estimate of the generalization error. Part of the discrepancy is due to where the evaluation points occur. The quantity can be thought of as extra sample error. Since the test input vectors do not need to coincide with the training input vector, the nature of the optimism and error is easiest to understand when we focus instead on the in sample error. And that is the equation. The y to the power 0 notation indicates that we observe n new response value at each of the training points xi, where I equal to 1 to n. We define the optimism as the difference between the error in and the training error, look like this. This is typically positive since error is usually biased downward as an estimate of prediction error. Finally, the average optimism is the expectation to the optimism over training set. That is the equation. Here the predictor in the training set is fixed and the exception is over the training set outcome values. Hence, we have used the notation EY instead of E of T. We can usually estimate only the expected error W rather than O in the same way that we can estimate the expected error rather than the conditional error. For a squared error 0 to 1 and other loss function, one can show quite generally that look like this equation, where covariance indicates covariance, thus the amount by which underestimates the true error depends on how strongly yi affects its own prediction. The harder we fit the data, the greater covariant yi cap yi will be, thereby increasing the optimism. In summary, we have the important relation like this. This is expression simplifies. In yi is obtained a linear weight by the inputs or bias function. For example, this is for the addition error model y equal to f of x plus epsilon, and so that is the equation. Basic for the definition of the effective numbers of parameters discussed in this lecture, the optimums increase linear with the number d of inputs or bias function we use, but decrease as the training sample size increase. An obvious way to estimate prediction error is to estimate the optimism and then read it to the training error. The method described in the CP, AIC, BIC and others works in that way for a special class of estimates that are linear in their parameters. In contrast, cross-validation and bootstrap method described later in the chapter are direct estimate of the extra sample error. These general tools can be used with any loss function and with nonlinear adaptive fitting technique. In sample error is not usually of direct interest since feature values of the feature are not likely to coincide with their training set values. But for comparison between models, in sample error is convenient and often leads to effective and model selection. The reason is that the relative size of the error is what matters. That is for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about estimates of in-sample prediction error. The general form of the in-sample estimate is this equation, where omega cap is an estimate of the average optimism. Using expression, applicable d parameter are fit under square error loss leads to a version of the so-called CP statistics like that equation. Here sigma epsilon cap square is an estimate of the noise variance obtained from mean square error of a low biased model. Using this criterion, we adjust the training error by a vector proportional to the number of basis function used. The archaic information criterion is a similar but more generally applicable estimate of error in when a log-likelihood loss function is used. It relies on a relationship similar to that holds asymptotically as n tends to infinity, and that is the equation. Here, p theta of y is a family of densities for y. Theta cap is the maximum likelihood estimate of theta, and log leak is the maximized log likelihood, and that is the equation. For example, for the logistic regression model, using the binary log likelihood, we have write this equation. For the Gaussian model, the AIC statistic is equivalent to CP, and so we refer to them collectively as AIC. To use AIC for model selection, we simply choose the model giving a small CIC over the set of model considered. For nonlinear and other complex models, we need to replace D by some measures of model complexity. Given a set of model f of alpha x indexed by the training parameter alpha, denoted by error alpha and d alpha the training error and number of parameters for each models, then for this set of models we define this equation. The function AIC of alpha provides an estimate of the test curve, and we find the training parameter alpha cap that minimized it. Our final chosen model is f of alpha cap of x. Note that if the basic function are chosen adaptively, no longer holds. For example, if we have a total of p inputs and we choose the best fitting linear model with d less than p input, the optimism will exceed 2d by n sigma epsilon square. Put another way, by choosing the best fitting model with d input, the effective number of parameters fit is more than d. A linear logistic regression model is used to predict the phonemes class with coefficient function beta of f equal to summation of m by m equal to 1 hm of f theta m, and expansion is m spline basis function. For any given m, a basis natural cubic spline is used for the hm. With nodes chosen uniformly over the range of frequencies, using IC to select the number of basis function will approximately minimize error m for both entropy and 0 to 1 loss. The example formula look like this. Holds exactly for linear model, additive error and square error loss, and approximately for linear model and log likelihood. In particular, the formula does not hold in general for 0 to loss, although many authors nevertheless use it in that context. And this is the picture. AIC used for model selection for the phonema recognition example of section 5 to 3. The logistic regression coefficient function beta of f equal to summation of m, m equal to 1 h of m of f theta m is modeled as an expansion is m spline basis function. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about starting values. Note that if the weights are non-zero, then the operative part of the sigmoid is roughly linear, and hence the neural network collapses into an approximately linear model. Usually, starting values for weight are chosen to be random values near zero. Hence, the model starts out nearly linear and becomes nonlinear as the weights increase. Individual units localize to direction and introduce nonlinearities where needed. Use of exact zero weights leads to zero derivatives and perfect symmetry, and the algorithm never moves. Starting instead with large weight often leads to poor solutions. Now, overfitting of a neural networks have too many weights and will overfit the data at the global minimum of R. In early developments of neural networks, either by design or by accident, an early stopping rule was used to avoid overfitting. Here we train the model only over a while and stop well before we approach the global minimum. Since the weight starts at a highly regularized solution, this has the effect of shrinking the final model towards a linear model. A validation dataset is usually for determining when to stop, since we expect the validation error to start increasing. A more explicit method for regularization is weight decay, which is analogs to Reed's regression used for linear methods. We add a penalty to the error function r theta plus lambda j theta, where that is the equation. And lambda greater than or equal 0 is a turning parameter. Larger value of lambda will tend to shrink the weights towards 0. Typically, cross validation is used to estimate lambda. The effects of the penalty is to simply add terms 2 beta kilometer and 2 alpha milliliter to the respective gradient expression. Other forms for the fluency have been proposed, like this equation 11.17. Known as the weight elimination penalty, this has the effect of shrinking a smaller weight more than does. The result of training a neural network with 10 hidden units without weight decay and with weight decay to the mixer example, weight decay has clearly improved the prediction heat maps of the estimated weights from the training. We see that weight decay has damped the weight in both layers. The resulting weights are separate, spread fairly evenly over the 10 hidden units. Now, scaling of the inputs. Since the scaling of the inputs determines the effective scaling of the weights in the bottom layer, it can have a large effect on the quality of the final solution. Now look at this picture. A neural network to the mixer example. The upper panel uses two weight decay and overfits the training data. The lower panel used weight dot decay and achieves close to the bias error rate. Both use the softmax activation function and cross entropy error. And this picture look like heat maps of the estimated weights from the training of neural networks. From the difference from bright green to bright red. At the outset, it is the best to standardize all inputs to have mean 0 and standard deviation 1. This ensures all inputs are treated quality in the regularization process and allows one to close a meaningful range for the random starting weights. With standardized inputs, it is typically to take random unit forwards over the range. Now, number of hidden units and layers. Generally, speaking, it is better to have too many hidden units than too few. With too few hidden units, the model might not have enough flexibility to capture the nonlinearities in the data. With too many hidden units, the extra weights can be shrunk towards zero if appropriate regularization is used. Typically, the number of hidden units is somewhere in the range of 5 to 100, with the number increasing with the number of input and number of training cases. It is most common to put down a reasonably large number of units and train them with regularization. Some researchers use cross-validation to estimate the optimal number, but this seems unnecessary if cross-validation is used to estimate the regularization parameter. Choice of the number of hidden layers is guided by background knowledge and experimentation. Each layer extracts feature of the input for regression or classification. Use of multiple hidden layers allows construction of hierarchical feature at different levels of resolution. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about multiple minima. The error function r theta is non-convex, possessing many local minima As a result, the final solution obtained is quite different to the choice of starting weights. One must at least try a number of random starting configuration and choose the solution giving low set error. Probably a better approach is to use the average prediction over the collection of networks as the final prediction. This is preferable to average the weights since the nonlinearity of the model implies that this averaged solution could be quite poor. Another approach is via bagging, which averages the predictions of networks training from randomly perturbed versions of the training data. Now example simulated data. We generated data from two attribute additive error models y equal to f of x plus epsilon. Sum of sigmoid like this and radial like this picture. Here x to the power t equal to x1, x2 to xp, each xj being a standard Gaussian variate with p equal to 2 in the first model and p equal to 10 in the second. For the sigmoid model, a1 equal to 3, 3, a2 equal to 3 minus 3 for the radial model, phi t equal to 1 by twice phi to the power half xpec minus t square by 2, both epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 are Gaussian errors with variance chosen so that the signal to noise ratio like this equation 11.80 is 4 in both models. We took a training sample of size 100 and a test sample of size 10,000. We fit neural network with weight decay and various numbers of hidden units and recorded the average test error e test y minus f cap of x square for each of 10 random starting weights. Only one training set was generated, but the results are typical for an average training set. The test error are shown. Note that the zero hidden unit model refers to linear least square regression. The neural network is perfectly suited to the sum of sigmoid model, and the two unit model does perform the best, achieving an error close to the byte rate. Notice, however, that with more hidden units, overfitting quickly crept in. And with some starting weights, the model does worse than the linear model. Even with two hidden units, two of the 10 starting weights configuration produce results no better than the linear model, confirming the importance of multiple starting value. A radial function is in a sense the model difficult of the neural net, as it is spherically symmetric and with no preferred dictionaries. We see in the right panel on figure look like this picture. That is, does poorly in this case with the test error stating well above the bias error. In fact, since a constant fit achieve a relative error of 5, we see that the neural network perform increasingly worse than the mean. In this example, we used a fixed weight decay parameter of 0.005 representing a mid amount of regularization. The result in the left panel of This picture suggests that more regularization is needed with greater numbers of hidden units. And in this picture, we repeat the experiment of the sum sigmoid model with no weight decay in the left panel and a stronger weight decay in the right panel. With no weight decay, overfitting becomes even more severe for larger number of hidden units. The weight decay value lambda equal to 0.1 produces good results for all numbers of hidden units, and there does not appear to be overfitting as the number of units increase. And finally, in this picture, shows that test error of a 10 hidden units network. Verifying the weight decay parameter over a wide range, the value 0.1 is approximately optimal. In summary, there are two free parameters to select, the weight decay lambda and number of hidden units m. As a learning strategy, one could fix either parameter at the value corresponding to the latest constraint model to ensure that the model is rich enough, and use cross validation to choose the other parameter. Here the least constraint values are 0 weight decay and 10 hidden units. Comparing the left panel of the previous picture to in this picture, we see that the test error is less sensitive to the value of the weight. Decay parameter, and this picture shows example of training cases from zip code data. Each image is has 60x60 8-bit grayscale representation of a handwriting digit, and hence cross validation of this parameter would be preferred. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about the SVM as a penalization method. With f of x equal to h of x to the power t beta plus, we not consider the optimization problem like this equation, where the subscript plus indicates position part. This has the form loss plus penalty, which is a familiar paradigm in function estimation. It is easy to show that the solution with lambda equal to 1 by c is the same. Examination of the Hinks loss function L of yf equal to 1 minus yf plus shows that it is responsible for two classification, and when compared to data more traditional loss function. The log likelihood of binomial deviance has similar tails as the SVM loss, giving zero penalty to point well inside their margin and linear penalty to points on the wrong side as far away. And that is the table. The population minimize for the defined loss function. Logistic regression use the binomial likelihood or deviance. linear discriminant analysis, y square error loss, the SVM Hinks loss, estimate the mode of the posterior class probabilities, where the other estimate a linear transformation of three probabilities. Linear plan T2 points on the wrong side and far away. A square error on the other hand gives a quadratic penalty, and points well inside their own margin have a strong influence on the model as well. The squared hinge loss L of YF equal to 1 minus YF square plus is like the quadratic, expect it is 0 for points inside their margin. It is still rise quadratically in the left tail and will be less worse than Hinks on deviation or misclassified observation. Recently, Ross and Zhu posted a revised version of the square Hinks loss, which converts smoothly to a linear loss at YF equal to minus 1. We can characterize these loss functions in terms of what they are estimating and the population level. We consider minimizing EL of Y of F of X. This table summarizes the results, where the Hinks loss estimate the classifier G of X itself, all the others. Estimate a transformation of the class posterior probabilities, the hybridized square Hinks loss share attractive properties of logistic regression, as well as the SVM Hinks loss. If H of X represents a hierarchical basic having some ordered structure, then the uniform shrinkage make more sense if the rougher elements Hj in the vector H have a smaller norm. All the loss function in this table. Expected square error are so called margin maximizing loss function. This means that if the data are separable, then the limit of beta lambda cap as lambda tends to 0 defines the optimal separating hyperplane. Now function estimation and reproducing kernels. Here we describe SVMs in terms of function estimation in reproducing kernel Hilbert space, where the kernel property abounds. This material is discussed in some detail. This provides another view of the support vector classifier and helps to clarify how it works. Suppose the basis H arises from the n expansion of a positive defined kernel A, and that is the 12.26 equation, and hm of x equal to root over del m phi of m of x, then y theta m equal to root of del m beta m. We can write this 12.27 equation. Now 12.27 equation is identical to the theory of reproducing kernel Hilbert space described the guarantees of finite dimensional solution of the form 12.28 equation. In particular, we see there an equivalent version of the optimization criterion. And this is the equation. where K is the n by n matrix of kernel evolution for all pairs of training features. This method are quite general and include, for example, the entire family of smoothing spines. Additive and interaction spline method discussed and in more detail in Wahaba and Hestai and Tipshinai. They can be expressed more generally as like this equation. Here, that is the structure space of function, and J of F an appropriate regularized on that space. For example, suppose looking H is the space of additive function f of x equal to summation of p j, j equal to 1 f of j x j, and j of f equal to summation of j f of x j square x j, then the solution is an additive cubic spine and has a kernel representation with k x of x dash equal to summation of p j equal to 1 k j x j x j dash. Each of the kj is kernel appropriate for the invariant smoothing spline in xj. Conversely, this discussion also shows that, for example, any of the kernels described above can be used with any convex loss function, and will also lead to a finite dimensional representation. The same kernel function expressed using the binomial log likelihood as a long function square. The fitted function is hence is estimate the log ors, and this is the equation 12.31, or conversely we get an estimate of the class properties like this equation. The filter models are quite similar in the shape and performance. Examples and more details are given in this lecture. It is does happen that of SVMs, a sizable fraction of the n values of alpha I can be 0. In the two examples, this fraction are %42 and 45% respectively. This is a consequence of the piecewise linear nature of the first part of the criterion. The lower the class overlap, the greater this fraction will be. Reducing lambda will generally reduce the overlap. A small number of support points names means the f of x cap can be evaluated more quickly, which is important at looking time. Of course, reducing the overlap too much can lead to poor generalization. And this is the picture, the logistic regression version of the AVM model using the identical kernel and hence penalties, but the log likelihood loss instead of the SVM loss function. The two broken contours correspond to posterior probabilities of 0.75 and 0.25 for the plus 1 class. The broken purple curve in the background is the Bayes decision boundaries. And this is the table that is skin for the orange. Shown are mean of the test error over 50 simulation. Brutof fits an editing spline model additively, while Mars fits a low order interaction model adaptively. That's it for now. Estimate the curve of dimensionally. In this section, we address the question of whether SVMs have some edge on the curve of dimensionally. Notice that in expression, we are not allowed a fully general linear product in the space of powers and products. For example, all terms of the from 2xj xj dash are given equal weight, and the kernel cannot adapt itself to concentrate on subspace. If the number of feature p were large, but the class separation occurred only in the linear subspace spanned by say x1 and x2. This kernel would not easily find the structure and would suffer from having many dimensions to search over. One would have to build knowledge about the subspace into the kernel, that is, tell it to ignore all but the first two puts. If such knowledge were available a priori, much of statistical learn without the kernel would easily find the subtract and would suffer having made dimension search over. Only you would have to build knowledge about the suspect in the kernel it is. The first class of four standard normally independent features x1, x2, x3, x4, and the second class also has four standard normal independence features, but confidence at 9 less than or equal summation of x, x square less than or equal 16. This is a relatively easy problem. As the second harder problem with arguments, hence the second class almost completely surrounds the first, like the row rate for the problem. We generated 1000 test observation and compared to different procedures. The advantage test errors over 50 simulations with and without noise features and shown in the earlier table. Line 1 used the support vector classifier in the original feature space. Linear 2 to 4 refer to the support vector machine with a 2 to 5 and 10 dimension null polynomial kernel. For all supports vector procedure, we choose the cost parameter C to minimize the test error to be as fair as possible to the method. Line 5 fits an additive spline model to the minus 1 and plus 1. It responds by last square using the Morioh algorithm for additive model described in Hastial and Tiffany. And that is the picture. Test error curves as a function of the cost parameter C for the radial kernel SVM classifier on the mixture data. At the top of each plot is the scale parameter gamma for the radial kernel. The bias error rate is indicated by the broken harmonized line. Line 6 uses MARS along interaction of all orders as described in. As such, it is comparable with the SVM polytain. Both Morioh and MARS have the ability to ignore redundant variables. Test error was not used to choose the smoothing parameter in either line 5 or 6. It is also very sensitive to the choice of kernel. The second degree polynomial kernel does best. Since the true decision on line boundary is the second log degree polynomial, however, higher degree polynomial kernels do much worse. Morioh perform well since the boundary is at TD. Morioh and MARS adapt well. Their performance does not deteriorate much in the presence of noise. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about a path algorithm for the SVM classifier. The regularization parameter of the SVM classifier is the cost parameter C, or East Inverse Lambda in. Common usage is to set C high leading up to somewhat overfit classifier. The test error on the maximum mixture data as a function C using defined radial kernel parameter gamma. When gamma equal to 5, then heaviest regularization is called for. With gamma equal to 1 and intermediate value of C is required. And that is the picture. A simple example illustrated the SVM path algorithm. This plot illustrated the state of the model at lambda equal to 0.5. The plus 1 points are orange and minus 1 blue, lambda equal to half, and the width of the sum margin is 2 by beta equal to 2 into 0.587. Two blues point curl bracket 3.5 are misclassified. When the two or end point, two orange point curl bracket 10,12 are correctly classified, but one the wrong side of the margin f of x equal to plus 1, each of the this has y f of x greater than less than 1. Clearly, a situation such as this, we need to determine a good choice for C. Perhaps by cross-validation, here we described a path algorithm for efficiently fitting the entire sequence of SVM models obtained by varying C. It is convenient to use the loss plus penalty formulation along with this leads to a solution for beta and the given value of lambda, and this is the equation look like this. The alpha are again language multipliers, but in the case they are all in square bracket 01. And previous picture illustrated the setup. It can be shown in the KKT optimality conditions imply that the labeled points xi, yi fall into three distinct groups. Observation correctly classified and outside their margins, they have yi f of xi greater than 1 and language multipliers alpha equal to 0. Example are the orange points 8, 9 and 11 and the blue points 1 and 4. Observation strings on the margins with yi f of xi equal to 1 with language multipliers alpha I belongs to 01. Examples are the orange 7 and the blue 2 and 8. Observation inside their margins have yi f of xi less than 1 with alpha equal to 1. Examples are the blue 3 and 5 and the orange 10 and 12. The idea for the path algorithm is as follows. Initially lambda is large, the margin 1 by beta lambda is wide and all points are inside their margin and have alpha equal to 1 as lambda decreases 1 by beta lambda decreases and the margin get narrower. Some points will move from inside their margin to outside their margins and their alpha I will change from 1 to 0. By continuity of the alpha I of lambda, these points will linger on the margin during this transition. We see that the points with alpha I equal to 1 make fixed contribution to beta lambda, and those with alpha I equal to 0 make two contribution. So all the changes as alpha decrease at the alpha I belongs to 01 of those of points on the margin. Since all these points have yi f of xi equal to 1, this result in a small set of linear equation that prescribe how alpha I, lambda and hence beta lambda changes during this transition. This result in piecewise linear path for each of the alpha I of lambda. The breaks occurs when points cross the margin. Although we have described this for linear SVMs, exactly the same idea works for nonlinear models. Is represented by like this equation. Details can be found in Hostile et al. An R package SVM path is available to CRAN for fitting this model. Now support vector machine for regression. We show how SVMs can be adapted for regression with a quantitative response in a way that inherits some of the properties of the SVM classifier. We first discard the linear regression model like this equation and then handle nonlinear generalization. To estimate beta, we consider minimization of this equation. And this is the picture. The left panel shows the epsilon insensitive errors function used by the support vector regression machine. The right panel shows the error function used in Hubbard's robust regression. Beyond C, the function changes from quadratic to linear. That is the 2.37 equation. This is an epsilon insensitive error measure, ignoring error of size less than epsilon. There is a rough analogy with the support vector classification setup, where points on the correct side of the decision boundary and far away from it are ignored in the optimization. In regression, these low error points are the one with the small residuals. It is interesting to contrast this with error measurement used in robust regression in statistics. The most popular due to Heber has the form like this equation. Shown in the right panel, the function reduced from quadratic to linear the contribution of observations with absolute residual greater than a pre-chosen constant C. This makes the fitting less sensitive to outliers. The support vector error measures also has linear tails, but in addition it flatters the contribution of those cases with a small residuals. If beta cap, beta cap naught are the minimizers of H, the solution function can be shown like this. Beta cap equation, this is the 12.39, and f of cap x equation, this is the 12.40, where alpha I cap and alpha I cap integer are positive and solve the quadratic program problem. And this is the equation. Subject to the contents alpha I and alpha integer equal to 0, that is the 12.41 equation. Due to the nature of these constants, typically only a subset of the solution values are non-zero and the associated data values are called the support vectors. As was the case in the classification setting, the solution depends on the input value only through the inner products xi, xi dash. Thus, we can generalize the model to richer space by defining an appropriate inner product. Note that there are parameters epsilon and delta associated with the criterion. This seems to play different roles. Epsilon is a parameter of the loss function, V of epsilon, just like C is for V of H. Note that both V of C and V of H depends on the scale of Y and hence R. If we scale our response, then we might consider using preset values for C and epsilon. The quantity lambda is a more traditional regulation parameter and can be estimated, for example, by cross-validation. Now, regression and kernels. As discussed in the course, this kernel properties is not unique to support vector machine. Suppose you consider approximation of the regression function in the I terms of a set of basis function that is look like this equation. To estimate beta and beta naught, that we can write h of beta point beta naught equal to in this 12.43 equation. For some general error measures VR, for any choice of VR, the solution f of x cap equal to summation of beta m cap h of x plus beta naught cap has the form look like this 12.44 equation. With k of xy equal to summation of capital M by small m, there small m equal to 1, hm of x, hm of y. Notice that this has the same form as both the radial basis function expression and a regularization estimate. For consistentness, let's work out the case vr equal to r square. Let h be the n by m basic matrix with mth element h of m of xi, and suppose that m greater than n is large. For simplicity, we assume that beta not equal to 0 or that the constant is absorbed in h. We estimate beta by minimizing the penalized least square criterion look like this 12.45 equation. The solution is y cap equal to capital H beta cap, that is 12.43 equation, with beta cap determined by, that is the 12.47 equation. From that is appear that we need to evaluate the M by M matrix of inner produce in the transform space. However, we can primitively by H to give like this 12.48 equation. The N by N matrix n h to the power t consists of inner products between pairs of observation I comma I dash, then that is the evaluation of an inner product kernel is easy to show directly in this case, that is predicted value at an iterability x satisfied like this equation, where alpha cap equal to h h to the power t plus lambda I to the power minus 1 y. As in the support vector machine, we need not specify or evaluate the large set of functions. Only the inner product kernel need to evaluate at the n training points for each I dash and the point x for predictions there. Careful choice of hm means, for example, that h h to the power t can be computed at the cost of n square by 2. Evaluation of k rather than the direct cost n square by n. It does not hold, for example, for the L1 norm beta, which may lead a superior model. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about unsupervised and supervised learning. We discuss a technique of transforming the density estimation problem into one of supervised function approximation. This forms the basis of the generalized association rules described in the next section. Let g of x be the unknown data probability density to be estimated, and go x to be a specified probability density function used for reference. For example, g naught x might be the uniform density over the range for the variables. Other possibilities are discussed below. The dataset x1, x2 to xn is presumed to be an IID random sample drawn from g of x. A sample of size n0 can be drawn from go of x using model Carlo method. Pulling these two data set and assigning mass w equal to n0 by n plus n0 to choose drawn from g of x and w0 equal to n by n plus n0 to those drawn from go of x result in the random sample drawn from the mixture density that is g of x plus go of x by 2. If one assign the value y equal to 1 to each sample points drawn from g of x and y equal to 0, those drawn from g of x, and then this is the equation 14.10. Can be estimated by supervised learning using the combined sample, and this is the equation number 14.11. As training data, the resulting estimate mu cap of x can be inverted to provide an estimate for g of x, and this is the equation g cap of x, that is 14.12. A generalized version of logic regression is especially well suited for the application since the log odds, and that is the 14.13 equation. I estimate directly in this case one has, and this is the picture density estimation via classification training set of 2000 data points. Training set plus 2000 reference data points generated uniformly over the rectangle containing the training data. The training sample was labeled as class 1 and the reference sample class 0, and a semi-parametric logistic regression model was fit to data. Some contours of g of x are shown like this. An example is shown. We generated a training set of size 200 shown in the left panel. The right panel shows the reference data generated uniformly over the rectangular containing the training data. The training sample was labeled as a class 1 and a reference sample class 0, and a logistic regression model using a tensor product of natural splines was fit to the data. Some probability contours of mu cap of x are shown in the right panel. These are also the contours of the density estimation g of x, since g of x equal to mu of x by 1 minus mu cap of x is a monotony function. The contours roughly capture the data density. In principle, any reference density can be used for go of x. In practice, the accuracy of the estimate g cap of x can depend greatly on particular choice. Good choice will depend on the data density g of x and the product procedure used to estimate. If accuracy is the goal, go of x should be chosen so that the resulting factor is mu of x or f of x are approximated easily by the method being used. However, accuracy is not always the primary goal. Both mu of x and f of x are monotonic functions of the density ratio g of x by g go of x. They can thus be viewed as contrast statistics that provide information concentrating differential of the data density g of x from the close reference density go of x. Therefore, in data analytic setting, a choice for go of x is dictated by typing our differential that are deemed most interesting in the context of the specific problem at hand. For example, if differentials from uniformity are of interest, go of x might be the uniform density over the range of the variable. If differential forms join normally are of interest, a good choice of go of x should be a Gaussian distribution with the same mean vector and covariance matrix as the data. Differential from independence could be investigation by using like this equation, where gj of xj is the marginal data density of xj, the jth coordinate of x. A sample from this independent density is easily generated from the data itself by applying a different random permutation to the data value of each of the variables. As discussed above, unsupervised learning is concerned with revealing properties of the data density. Each technique focused on a particular property or set of properties. Although this approach of transforming the problem to one of supervised learning seems to have been part of this statistics folklore for some time, it does not appear to have had much import despite its potential to bring well-developed supervised learning methodology to bear on unsupervised learning problems. One reason may be that the problem must be enlarged with a simulated data set generated by Monte Carlo techniques. Since the size of the data set should be at least as large as the data sample and not greater than equal n, the computation and memory requirement of the estimation procedure at least double. Also, substantial computation may be required to generate the Monte Carlo sample itself. Although perhaps a deterrent in the past, this increased computation requirement are becoming much less of a burden as increased resource becoming routinely available. We illustrated the use of supervising learning methods for unsupervised learning in the next lecture. Now, generalized association rule. The more general problem of finding high density region in the data space can be addressed using the supervised learning approach described above. Although not applicable to the huge database for which market basket analysis is feasible, useful information can be obtained from moderately sized data sets. The problem can be formulated as finding subset of the integers and corresponding value subset as j belongs to j for the corresponding value x. So that is the equation number 14.6 is large. Following the numerical chart of association rule analysis will be called a generalized item set. The subset Sj corresponding to quantitative variable are taken to be contiguous intervals within their range of value, and subset for categorical variables can involve more than a single value. The ambitious nature of this formulation precludes a thorough search for all generalized item sets with supports greater than a specified minimum threshold as is possible in the more restrictive setting of market basket analysis. Heuristic search methods must be employed, and the most one can hope for this find a useful collection of such generalized item set. Both market basket analysis and the generalized formulation implicitly refers the uniform probability distribution. One seek item sets that are more frequent than would be expected if all joint data values were informally distributed. This favored the discovery of item set whose marginal constituents are individually frequent, that is the quantity in this equation. In large, conjunction of frequent subset will tend to appear more often among items set of higher support than conjunction of marginally less frequent subset. This is why the rule vodka to caviar is not likely to be discovered in spite of a high association. Neither item has high marginal support, so that their joint support is especially small. Reference to the uniform distribution can cause highly frequent items set with low associated among their constituents to dominate the collection of highest support item sets. Highly frequent subset SJ are formed as disjunction of the most frequent XJ value. Rules like vodka to caviar would have a chance of emerge. It is not clear, however, how to incorporate reference distribution other than the uniform into the a priori algorithm. As explained in section, it is straightforward to generate a sample from the product density given the original data set. After choosing a reference distribution and drawing a sample from it is an in. One has a supervised learning problem with a binary valued output variable y belongs to 0, 1. The goal is to use the training data, find the region like this equation r equal to, for which the target function mu of x equal to e of y by x is relatively large. In addition, on might which we require the data support of this region, not v too small, look like this equation. That is it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about choice of supervised learning method. The region are defined by conjunctive rules, hence supervised methods that learn such rules would be most appropriate in this context. The terminal nodes of a curved decision tree and defined by rules previously opt from applying curved to the pool data will produce a decision tree that attempts to model the target over the entire data space by a disjoint set of region. Each region is defined by a rule of the form those terminal nodes t with high average y values, that is the y bar t into av yi by xi belongs to t, are candidates for high support generalized item sets. The actual support is given by this, look like this. When nt is the number of observation within the region represented by the terminal node, by examining the resulting decision tree, one might discover interesting generalized item set of relatively high support. This can then be partitioned into antecedent and consequence in a search for generalized association rules of high coefficient and or lift. Another natural learning method for this purpose is the paint rule induction method, prim described. Prim also produces rules precisely of the form, but it is especially designed for finding high support region that maximize the average target value within them. Rather than trying to model the target function over the entire data space, it also provides more control over the support / average target value trade-off. Issue that arise with either of these method when we generated random data from the product of the marginal distribution. Now example market basket analysis continued. We illustrated the use of prim on the demographics data. Three of the highest support generalized item set emerging from the prim analysis we are following. Item set 1 support the 24%, and that is you are looking, and item set 2 that is support equal to 24% and age less than or equal 14, you will look like this. And item set 3 support equal to 15%, that is householder star is equal to rent. General association rules derived from this item set with confidence gather the 95% are the following. Associated rule number 1, support 25%, confidence 99.7% and lift it 1.35%. That's marital status equal to marital. Association rules 2 is support 25%, confidence 98.7% and lift 1.97%. And association rule 3 is support 25%, confidence 95.9% and lift 2.61%. Associated rule 4, that is support 15%, confidence 95.4% and lift 1.50. You look like this picture. There are no great super surprise among these particular rules. For the most part, they vary institution. In other contexts where there is less prior information available, unexpected results have a greater chance to emerge. This result too illustrated the type of information generalized association rules can provide, and that the supervised learning approach coupled with a rule induction method such as cut or prime can uncover item sets exhibiting high association among their constituents. How do these generalized association rules compare to those found earlier by the appropriate algorithm? Since the appropriate procedure gives thousands of rules, it is difficult to compare them. However, some general points can be made. The appropriate algorithm is exhaustive. It finds all rules with support generator, then a specified amounts in contrast. Prim is a greedy algorithm and is not guaranteed to give an optimal set of rules. On the other hand, the appropriate algorithm can deal one with dummy variable and hence could not find some of the above rules. For example, since type of home is a categorical input with a dummy variable for each level, appropriate could not find a rule involving the set. Type of home is not equal to apartment. To find this set, we would have to code a dummy variable for apartment versus the other categories of type of home. It will not generally be feasible to pre-code all such potentially interesting comparisons. Now cluster analysis. Cluster analysis, also called data segmentation, has a variety of goals, all related to grouping of segmenting a collection of objects into subset or cluster such that those within each cluster are more closely related to one another than objects assigned to different clusters. An object can be described by a set of measurements or by its relation to other objects. In addition, the goal is sometimes to arrange the clusters into a natural hierarchy. This involves successively grouping the clusters themselves so that at each level of their hierarchy, cluster within the same group and more similar to each other than those in different groups. And this is the picture. Simulated data in the plane cluster into three classes by the k-means cluster algorithm. Cluster analysis is also used to from descriptive statistics to ascertain whether or not the data consist of a set distinct subgroup, each group representing object with substantiality defined properties. This latter goal requires an assessment of the degree of difference between the object assigned to the respective clusters. Central to all of the goals of cluster analysis is the notion of the degree of similarity between the individual object being clustered. A cluster method attempts to group the object based on the definition of similarity supplied to it. This can only come from object matter consideration. The situation is somewhat similar to the specification of a loss or cost function in prediction problem. These are costs associated with an inaccurate prediction depend on consideration outside the data. Some simulated data cluster into three groups via the popular k-means algorithm. In this case, two of the clusters are not well separated, so that segmentation more accurately describes the part of this process than clustering k-means. Clustering start with guesses for the three cluster centers. Then it alternates the following step until convergence. For each data input, the closest cluster inter is identified. Each cluster inter is repeated by coordinate wise average of all data points that are closer to it. We describe k-means clustering is more detailed, including the problem of how to choose the number of clusters. K-means cluster is a top-down procedure, while other cluster approaches that we discuss are bottom-up. Fundamental to all clustering technique is the choice of distance or dissimilarity means measure between two objects. We first discuss distance measure before describing a variety of algorithm for clustering. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching.
Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about learning a good ensemble. Not all ensemble TL will perform well with post-processing. In terms of basic function, we want a collection that covers the space within places. And that is the picture. Application of the lasso post processing to the SVM data. The horizontal blue line is the test error of a random forest fed to the SVM data. Using 1000 trees grown to maximum depth, the judged blue curve is the test error after post-processing the first 500 trees using the lasso. As a function of the number of trees with non-zero coefficient, the orange curve of the line is a modified form of random forest, where a random drone of 5% of the data are used to grow each tree, and the trees are forced to be shallow. Here the post-processing offers much greater improvement over the random forest that generated the ensemble, where they are needed and are sufficiently defined from each other for the post-processor to be effective. Friedman and Popescu gain insights for numerical quadrature and important sampling. They view the unknown function as a integral, and that is the equation number 16.10, where gamma belongs to t index, the basic function v of xy. For example, if the basic function are trees, then gamma indexes the splitting variable, the split point, and the values in the terminal nodes. Numerical quadrature amounts to finding a set of m evaluation points. Gamma of m belongs to t and corresponding weight alpha m, so that f of m of x equal to alpha naught plus summation of capital M by m, that where m equal to 1, alpha m v of x gamma m approximates f of x well over the domain of x. Important sampling amounts to sampling gamma at random, but giving more weight to relevant region of the space. Friedman and Popescu suggest a measure of relevance that uses the loss function. And that is the equation number 16.11, that is the Q of gamma. Evaluated on the training data, if a single basic function were to be selected, it would be the global minimizer gamma integer equal to argument minimum gamma belongs to Q of gamma. Introducing randomness in the selection of gamma would necessarily produce less optimal values with Q of gamma less than or equal to Q of gamma integer. They propose a natural measure of the characteristic weight sigma of the sampling scheme S. And that is the equation sigma equal to S of Q of gamma minus Q of gamma integer. Sigma too narrow suggests too many of the V of x, y, gamma look alike and similar V x gamma integer. Sigma too wide implies a large separate in the x gamma m, but possibly consisting of many irrelevant cases. Friedman and Popescu use subsampling as a mechanism for introducing randomness leading to their sampling generation algorithm. f of x equal to argument minimum c summation of n by I equal to 1, l equal to I by c. SM refers to the subsample of n eta. Eta belongs to 0, 1 of the training observed variation, typically without replacement. Their simulation suggests picking eta less than or equal to half, and for large n picking eta 1 by root 10. Receding eta increases the randomness and hence the wide sigma. The parameter v belongs to 0, 1 introduces memory into the randomization process. The larger V, the more the procedure avoids V x, comma, similar to those found before. A number of familiar randomization schemes are a special case of algorithm. Random forest sampling is similar with more randomness introduced by the section of the splitting variable. Reducing eta less than half in algorithm has a similar effect to reducing M is random forest, but does not suffer from the potential biases. Gradient boosting with shrinkage 10 point uses eta equal to 1, but typically does not pursue sufficient width sigma. The authors recommend values v equal to 0.1 and eta less than or equal half and call their combined procedure. Important sampled learning assembling. And this is the picture shows the performance of the ISL on the SM data. It does not improve the predictive performance, but is able to pursue a more parsimonious model. Note that in practice, the post-processing includes the selection of the regularization parameter sigma, which would close by cross validation. Here we simply demonstrated the effects of post processing by showing the various ISL on a progress example. The generating function is f of x equal to 10, phi of j equal to 1 into the power minus 2x of j, that is the function. And that is the picture demonstrated of assembling method on a regression simulation example. The notation GBM refers to a gradient boosted model with parameters. We report mean square error from the true function. Note that the subsampled GBM model outperforms the full GBM model. The lasso post process version achieved similar error. The random forest is outperformed by its post processing version, but both fall short of the other models like this. Now rule assembling. Here we describe a modification of tree assembling method that focuses on individual rules. We encountered rules in the decision of the prim method. The idea is to enlarge an assembly of trees by constructing a set of rules from each of trees in the collection. And this is the picture, a typical tree in assembly. Despite a small tree with assembled nodes, this is the rule can be derived from this tree, that is the 16.14. A linear expansion is rule 1, 4, 5 and 6 is equivalent to the tree itself, hence is an overcompleted basic for the tree. For each tree TMM in an assembled tree, we can construct its mini assemblage of rules, TM rules, and then combine them all to form a larger assemblage. And this is the equation. This is then treated like any other assemble and post processed via the lasso or similar regularized procedure. There are several advantages to this approach of deriving rules from the more complex trees. The space of models is enlarged and can lead to improved performance. And this is the picture minuscule error for rule assemblers using 20 realization of the simulation example. Rules are easier to interpret than trees, so there is the potential for a simplified model. It is often natural to argument t rules by including each variable xj separately as well, thus allowing the ensemble to model linear function well. Friedman and Popescu demonstrated the power of this procedure on a number of illustrative examples, including the simulation example. This picture shows box plot of the mean square error from the true model for 20 realizations for this model. The model were all fit using the rule fit software available on the SL homepage, which runs in an automatic model. On the same training set as used, the rule-based model achieved a mean square error of 1.06. Although slightly worse than the best achievement in the figure, the results are not comparable because cause validation was used here to select the final model. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about assembly learning. The idea of assembly learning is to build a prediction model by combining the strength of a collection of simpler based modules. We have already seen a number of examples that fall into this category. Boosting was initially proposed as a committed method as well, although unlike random forest, the committee of weak learners involved over time and the members cast a weighted vote. In fact, one could characterize any dictionary's method, such as regression exponents, as an ensemble method with the basic function serving the role of the weak learner. Bayesian method for non-parametric regression can also be viewed as ensemble methods. A large number of candidate methods are averaged with respect to the Fourier distribution of the parameter settings. Ensemble learning can be broken down into two tasks: developing a population of best learner from the training data and then combining them to form the composite predictor. In this lecture, we discuss boosting technology that goes a step further. It builds an ensemble model by conducting a regularized and supervised search in a high dimensional space of a weak lecture. An early example of a learning ensemble is a method designed for multi-class classification using error correcting output codes. Consider the 10-class digit classification problem and the training matrix C given that table. Note that lth column of the coding matrix CL defines a two class variables that merge all the original classes into two groups. The method works as follows. Number 1. Learn a separate classifier for each of the L equal to 15 two-class problems defined by columns of the coding matrix. At a test point x, let's PL cap x to be predicted probability of a 1 for the lth response. Define del k of x summation of L equal to 1 CKL minus PL cap x, the risk limit function for the kth class, where CKL is the entry of the row K column L is the in the table. Each row of C is a binary code for representing that class. The rows have more bits than necessary, and the idea is that redundant error correcting bits allows for some encouraging. James and Hasty 1998 analyzing the ECOG approach and shows error correcting codes. That also argues that the main benefit of the coding was the invariance reduction, because the difference code problems resulted in different risks, and the decoding step above have a similar effect as averaging, regularization paths, overfitting, and margins. It has often been observed that boosting does not overfit, or more astutely, in slow or overfit. Part of the explanation for this phenomena was made earlier for random forest. Misclassification error is less sensitive to variance that is mean squared error, and classification is the major focus in the boosting community. The coefficient paths this picture shows the coefficient path for lasso and infinitesimal forward stage-wise in a simulated regression setting. The data consists of a dictionary of 1000 Gaussian variables strongly correlated within block of 20, but uncorrelated between blocks. The generating model has non-zero. The FS not algorithm is a limited from the algorithm where the step size is shrunk to zero. The grouping of the variables in intent to mimic the correlation of nearby trees and with the forward stepwise algorithm. This step is intent as a idealized version of gradient boosting with shrinking. For both this algorithm, the coefficient path can be computed exactly, since they are piecewise linear. Here the coefficient profit and similar only in the earlier stage of the path. For the later stage, the forward stepwise path tend to be monotony and smoother, while those for the lasso functioned widely. This is due to the strong correlations among the subset of the variables. Lasso suffer somewhat from the multi collinearity problems. Hasty et al. Shows the FSO solves a monotony version of the lasso problem for squared error loss. Let T alpha equal to TU curl bracket minus T be the argument dictionary. Obtain the including a negative copy of every basic element in T. We consider module f of x equal to summation of tk belongs to T alpha, alpha k tk x with non-negative coefficient alpha k greater than equal 0. In this expanded space, the lasso coefficient paths are positive, which those of FSO are monotone, non-decreasing. The monotone lasso path is characterizing by different equation like this. And this is the picture with initial coordinate alpha 0 equal to 0, where L is the L1 arc length of the path alpha L. The monotonous lasso move direction decrease of the loss of the optimal quadratic rate per unit increase in the L1 arc length of the path. Since pk to the power mile alpha L greater than equal 0, the solution per the monotonous. In this argument dictionary, restricting the coefficient to be positive is natural, since it avoids an obvious ambiguity
It also ties in more naturally with tree boosting. We always find tree positively correlated with the current residual. Three have been suggestion that boosting perform well because it exhibit maximum margin properties, much like the support vector machine of 8199. Define the normalized L1 margin of a fitted model f of x equal to summation of k alpha k t k x as look like this, and that is the picture. The left panel shows the L1 margin in f for the AdaBoost classifier on the mixer data as a function of the number of 4 node trees. The model was fit using the R package GVM with a shrinkage factor of 0.02. After 10,000 trees, M of F has settled down. Note that when the margin crosses 0, the training error becomes 0. The right panel shows the test error, which is minimized at 24 trees. In this case, AdaBoost overfit. Domestically, it ran on convenience. Collecting together the result of the selection, we reach the following summary of the boost classifiers. The sequence of boosted classifier from an L1 regularized monotone path to a margin maximized solution. Of course, the margin maximized ends of the path can be a very poor overfit solution, as it is the example early stopping amounts of picking a point along the path and should be done with the aid of a validation dataset. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about undirected graphical models. A graph consists of a set of varieties along with a set of edge joining some pairs of the varieties. In graphical models, each vertex represents a random variables and the graph gives a visual way to understanding the joint distribution of the entire set of random variables. They can be useful for either supervised or supervised learning. In an undirected graphical, the edges have no direction arrows. We restrict the discussion to undirected graphical models, also known as Markov random fields, as Markov networks. In this graph, the absence of an edge between two vertices has a special meaning of corresponding random variables and continuously independent given the other variable. This picture shows an example of a graphical model for a flow cyclometry dataset with p equal to 11, potent measured on n equal to 7,466 cells for SCAS E12 2003. Each vertex in the graph corresponds to the real valued expression level of a potent. The network structure was estimated assuming a multivariate Gaussian distribution using the graphical lasso product procedure discussed later in this lecture. A sphere graph have a relatively small number of edges and are convenient for interpretation. They are useful in a variety of domains including genomic and proteomic, where the provide raw model of cell pathways. As we will see, the edge in a graph and parameterized by value or potential that encode the instance of the conditional difference between the random variables at the corresponding vertices. The main challenge in working with graphical model and model selection, estimation of the edge parameter of data and computation of marginal vertex
probabilities and exceptions from their join distribution. We do not attempt a comprehensive treatment of this interesting area. Instead, we introduce some basic concepts and then discuss a few simple methods for estimation of the parameters and structure of undirected graphical models. Methods that related to the techniques already discussed, this estimation approach that we present for continuous the discrete values verticals are defined, so treat them separately. Directed graphical model represent probability distribution that can be factorized into product of conditional distribution and have the potential of crucial interpretation. We refer the render of Weatherman for a brief overview of both undirected and directed graph. The next session follows closely. Look like, and this is the picture example of undirected graphical model or Markov network. Each node or vertex represent a random variable, and the lack of edge between two nodes indicate content independence. A longer list of useful reference, and that is the lecture. Thank you for watching. Hello everyone, welcome to the course. In this lecture, I am telling you about undirect graphical models for continuous variables. Here we consider Markov network where all the variables are continuous. The Gaussian distribution is almost always used for such graphical models because of its convenient analytical properties. We assume that the observation have a multivariable Gaussian distribution with mean, mu and covariance matrix summation. Since the Gaussian distribution represents at most second order relationship, it automatically encodes a pairwise Markov graph. The Gaussian distribution has the property that all conditional distributes are also Gaussian. The inverse covariance matrix summation inverse minus 1 contains information about the partial covariance between the variables. That is the covariance between pairs I and J conditioned on all other variables. In particular, if the ijth component of theta equal to summation of minus 1 is 0, then variable I and J are conditionally independent given the other variables. In this instructive of example, the conditional distribution of one variable versus the rest, where the role of theta is explicit, suppose the partition x equal to z y, where z equal to x1 to xp minus 1, consists of the first p minus 1 variables, and y equal to xp is the last. Then we have the conditional distribution of y gives z. Look like this equation. The conditional match in 70.6 equation has exactly the same form of the population multiple linear regression of y on z with the regression coefficient. If we partition theta is the same way, since summation of theta equal to I, standard formula for partition inverse give this is the equation. We have learned two things here: the dependency of y on z in 70.6 equation in the mean learn alone. Here we see explicitly that zero elements in beta
and hence theta z to I means that the corresponding elements of z are conditionally independent of y given the rest. And number two, we can learn about this dependence structure through multiple linear regression. That's it for the lecture. Thank you for watching.